Greetings and salutations. When one looks around at the state of affairs in the United States, from the lead poisoning crisis in Flint, Michigan, to the dumbed-down soundbite American Idol contest for president, the overriding question that has to be asked is, how did we allow all this to happen? The hard, simple truth is apathy. Because in a republic that is of the people, for the people, and by the people, the citizens must be vigilant in their civic duties. Many things contribute to a population's political apathy, but its roots start in a country's civic education. And according to a recently released report by the American Council of Trustees and Alumni, we are in a crisis in civic education. The report has compiled some pretty startling findings on the civic uneducation of our young American minds, stating that survey after survey shows that recent college graduates are alarmingly ignorant of America's history and heritage. They cannot identify the term lengths of Congress members, the substance of the First Amendment, or the origin of the separation of powers. They do not know the father of the Constitution, and nearly 10% say that Judge Judy is on the Supreme Court. Yes, Judge Judy is on the Supreme Court. If it's truly that bad, then now more than ever, we need to practice our civic duty and start watching the Hawks.
If you want to know what's going on in your city, in your streets, never back down like Tyrell, then the truth is what you seek. To analyze, investigate from the bottom to the top. You speak your mind like Sean Stone, whether they like it or not. I got Tabitha, Miss Wallace, with the wisdom and the pearl. Between the outrage and the evidence, what's going on in this world?
Watching the Hawks, watching the Hawks. Watching the Hawks, listen when they talk.
Welcome everybody to Watching the Hawks. I am Tyrell Ventura, and joining us today, special guest host, RT's Lindsay France. Thank you, Lindsay, for coming on today.
My pleasure.
Tabitha's on special assignment, top secret. We should be coming back with that soon, but we start off, obviously, with, wow, are we really that dumb? Is our civics really that bad? I ask you, Lindsay, you're a reporter, you're on the ground, you're out there in with people. Are the American college students really that stupid about civics that they screw up Judge Judy
who's
on the Supreme Court?
You think so? Now, granted, I haven't been in college in quite a while. Undergrad was eons ago. But I will say, you know, if you look at the listings for classes in most liberal arts colleges, you've got Batman. You've got, you know, the societal implications of Batman. You've got bowling. You've got the craziest school offerings. And the thing is, why isn't there more sort of enforced curriculum that is civics 101? Mm-hmm. And if you look at immigrants coming to this country, they've got to take tests. They've got to know basic government structure. And how are we graduating these people that can't, I mean, for me, it's they can't find China on a map, let alone know, you know, who the shine limit.
And these you know, findings are across the board. I mean, you're seeing it in high schools now, you're seeing it in colleges, and as I said, you know, the basic tenet of this country, in order, if you're going to have a republic for the people, of the people, by the people, that people has to be educated enough to understand how the basic systems work.
Right.
That is why you see things like the lead poisoning in Detroit when you have government breakdown and bad decision making. That's why you see things, you know, of you know, like I said, the presidential career just kind of spitting out fact, you know, spitting out ideas without any real basis. I mean, you know, without any real idea of legislature, no one's asking the right questions on the campaign trail. I mean, almost 40% of college graduates didn't know that Congress has the power to declare war, which isn't actually that surprising.
That's fair. Yeah. In the time these kids have been in college, there's been a lot of executive actions. So it makes sense they think that, but
I mean,
okay.
You look at more of these. In 2012, the ACTA survey found that less than 20% of American college graduates could accurately identify the effect of the Emancipation Proclamation, which is a pretty big part of our history. In 2014, they found that one-third of college graduates were unaware that that FDR spearheaded the New Deal. I mean, these are basic tenets of our history. Almost half of them couldn't recognize that senators are elected to six-year terms and representatives are elected to two-year terms. Now, how the heck are you going to have an informed voting public when we're not even giving them this basic education in these things?
Well, of course. I mean, if you look at, these are young voters. These people are just starting out. They've got a degree. They try to go out and get a job. And how are they supposed to elect leaders that they know are going to actually serve their interests? And not only that, you're going to get people voting on emotion instead of knowing exactly what they can do.
Exactly. Now, it's interesting, we were talking earlier, you actually pointed out and found some flaws in the Judge Judy question, the 10%. You look at the 10%. You found some flaws in
that. Yeah, I did. Here's the thing. They didn't say Judge Judy. They said Judith Shineland. Apparently, that's her last name.
Yeah.
She also wears lace around the collar.
Oh, so that would confuse them.
Perhaps, but I think they didn't know who it was. Well, and not only that, if they're asking this in a pub quiz, that's not fair.
These were the questions you're seeing on screen right now. That's Elena Kagan, who sits on the Supreme Court, Lawrence Pierce. These were the people that are on the list that they said, you know, A, B, or C, pick one. As you see, 9% picked Judith. 5% picked John Kerry, which is pretty amazing to me that they screwed that one up. You know, Lawrence Pierce served on the Supreme Court. Elena Kagan's currently sitting on the Supreme Court. You know, so, I mean, I look at that and say, yeah, okay, they didn't put Judge Judy on the questionnaire, but, I mean, what, they're going to just guess?
Well, did they put her picture?
No, okay. It's just A, B, or C, where they could just guess. I mean, it's really ridiculous when they're going to pick that at the end of the day.
Yeah, I know. It is sad, and they should know these names. Do you know these names?
Do I know the names on the Supreme Court?
Do you know? Do it. Try
okay.
it.
Okay, Sotomayor, Alito, Roberts, Kagan, Joe Brown, Judge Judy, and
Judge Ito
from O.J. Simpson. Ooh, all right.
We just dated ourselves.
A little bit, a little bit.
Well, everybody, Donald Trump did a mic drop at Liberty University. This time he took aim at Apple. Now, according to the Trumpster, Apple is an example of corporations gutting the United States of its manufacturing jobs by going overseas. Tabitha Wallace takes a look at this statement.
This week, while speaking at Liberty University, Republican presidential candidate Donald Trump vowed that if elected, he would impose a 35% tax on American corporations who produce goods overseas, specifically saying, we're going to get Apple to build their damn computers in this country instead of other countries. There are a few obvious problems with Trump making this claim. One is that the president doesn't have the power to prohibit U.S. companies from outsourcing. Secondly, bringing manufacturing back to the U.S. requires upending and shifting the world's economy. Also, not something a single president can do. Aside from restructuring supply chains, infrastructure, and trade deals, it requires something a Republican president is going to have a hard time getting the party on board for: mass education. See, when Apple was planning to manufacture the iPhone, they realized that they needed close to 9,000 industrial engineers to oversee nearly 250,000 assembly line workers with the skills and speed needed to meet the demand of iPhone sales. The problem? Well, the U.S. just isn't producing a qualified labor force to meet those demands. In the case of Apple, it was estimated that it would take over 9 months to recruit those 9,000 industrial engineers. Well, Foxconn, the Taiwanese multinational company responsible for manufacturing iPhones, could do it in 2 weeks. In 2012, the New York Times looked into how the U.S. lost the manufacturing of the iPhone to Foxconn. Apple executives concluded that though Americans are among the most educated workers in the world, the nation has stopped training enough people with mid-level skills that factories need. And recently on 60 Minutes, Apple CEO Tim Cook had this to say about the issue.
China put an enormous focus on manufacturing in what we would call, you and I would call, vocational kind of skills. The U.S. over time began to stop having as many vocational kind of skills. I mean, you could take every tool and die maker in the United States and probably put them in the room they were currently sitting in. In China, you would have to have multiple football fields. And so,
because they've taught those skills in their schools.
It was a focus of them. It's a focus of their educational system.
So as politicians around the country look to cut funding to education while also looking to increase manufacturing jobs, how will the paradox this creates affect the working class?